All right. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome back to CRC Music in the Studio. It's a new year. It's a new series for us, and we're really excited to bring you this offering this semester. Last year was our first time doing this, and for those of you new joining us for the first time, whether you're on YouTube or here on Zoom, this is a series that we wanted to start in response to the COVID-19 pandemic and our move to distance learning. We wanted to make sure that our students are staying inspired and staying engaged and doing something to support our students who are not only in our broader CRC community and in Sacramento here, but around the country, those people who are joining us and not directly students of ours or acquaintances of ours. But the other thing we wanted to do with this series is we wanted to kind of extend opportunities to the musicians out there that would otherwise be touring and playing gigs and are finding themselves at home doing some other things instead. And we really want to make sure that we're, highlighting them, showcasing these musicians. So we have a really unique opportunity to bring musicians from all over the country, all over the world, really, to talk to our students, to talk to you directly about what their experiences in music have been. And this series is all about career development and content creation. So I'm really excited to share with you the experiences of a person I've known for maybe 20 years now. I think it's been 20 years.
At
exactly.
Least.
Yeah, this is the great trumpet player, Augie Haas. Everybody say hello to Augie Haas. Welcome.
Ooh.
Good to see you, man.
How are you? Good to see you. You look well. You look like you're getting that California sun. Not that Wisconsin winter.
You know, that's why we moved out here. That's why we moved.
Yeah.
I'm feeling well. It's definitely been an interesting time, spending a lot more time at home, but eating right, exercising, taking care of the self, and that is an important thing. Now, I think many of us are dealing with the same kind of concepts and working on our health and physical and mental, of course. So what about you? Where are you coming to us from? Are you in New York right now?
I'm in New York, have stayed here throughout throughout all of this craziness. My wife and I in our 600 square foot apartment, so that's been fun. It's been interesting, but we haven't killed each other yet, so that's good. Waiting this thing out and trying to stay safe, and again working on the health and eating right and all those things, mental and physical.
That's great. I gotta say, just before we get into what you do and who you are, that you are an amazing chef. And if you haven't checked out Augie's Instagram and Facebook and all that kind of stuff, you will see photos of the food that he makes. So I know that you are doing things right over there, and it's inspired me to eat better myself. And so hopefully I'll be following in your footsteps. You got something on the recipe or the menu for tonight?
I was going to do maybe some, keep it simple, maybe some barbecue chicken with some cauliflower puree and some other type of veg. Trying to go veggie heavy these days.
Yeah, no big deal. Cauliflower puree, little barbecue chicken. That's great, man. Well, I wanted to just kind of musically introduce you to everybody as well. So I wanted to share a clip that features you playing on the road with Harry Connick Jr. You are what some people would call a lead trumpet player, but you just play all kinds of trumpet, but specifically this designation of lead trumpet is something that's kind of a specialized role. Do you want to talk a little bit about what that is?
There is a sense of it just being an obvious answer of that the lead trumpet player leads, and when you're playing in a section, you're kind of listened to for articulation, phrasing, releasing of the notes, and overall stylistic view. So for most of my career, I've been known as in that role of being a lead trumpet player.
Yeah, and you're also a fabulous improviser. So we're gonna take a look at the solo that you took while on the road with Harry Connick Jr. So I'm gonna share my screen here. We'll take a little listen to you. Yeah. killing.
Yeah. It hurts just watching it.
Now, is that the case? I mean, of course, lead trumpet players tend to be high note specialists as well. Man, you really work hard up there. Is this something that you've had to train for? Like, how, is this something you've always done? You've always kind of been a specialist in that regard?
Yeah, I mean, it's certainly something that I've worked on, you know, and tried to specialize over the years. You know, I think that when you're growing up, you know, and like everyone goes into their high school big band and all of a sudden, like, you know, that person just gets thrown into the lead chair, you know, and it's like whether you want it or not in high school. So, you know, for better or worse, that was me. And then when I went to college and mostly studied with Rob Parton, you know, we really worked in on honing just being an overall really good trumpet player, with having that, you know, kind of specialty of being able to play in the upper register.
Right. It's only a certain percentage of what you do, I'm sure. I mean, most of the time you're just playing music like anything else, like any other trumpet player in the orchestras or any other you know, ensemble, depending.
Yeah, absolutely.
Where you are. Good. Yeah. So how did you get to this point where you are now? You went to Chicago to study.
Yep.
And then what happened after that?
I did my undergrad in Chicago at Roosevelt, Chicago College of Performing Arts, and had a great time. And then, again, I said I studied with Rob Parton, and also my last year I studied with Roger Ingram, who is obviously one of the premier lead trumpet players of all trumpet playing. So, or all trumpet players rather. And then I did my master's and doctorate at the University of Miami, which was great. Learned so much and had the good fortune of playing in a big band, you know, 5 days a week for 2 hours a day. So like, you know, you really, really have the opportunity to just hone that skill. And I was the lead trumpet player in the big band at the school. Did a lot of touring and working while I was down there and try, you know, you, like anything, you try and make the connections. And then after that, I moved up to New York in 2011. Been here ever since.
Oh, wow. Okay. So was it a particular job that took you there, or were you kind of like, well, in order to play for a living, I need to go to a place where there are gigs, and then I transplanted and then you found the gigs while you were there?
Yeah. I mean, I think it was kind of a little bit of both. Like, you want to go to the places that there are gigs, you know, the bigger cities, Chicago or LA or, you know, San Francisco or New York, and Miami is a great place for that too. But I had the good fortune of starting to tour with Maria Schneider's band in 2009. She had just come to the school as a guest artist, and then something happened where she needed the trumpet player. And so I flew up to New York and played with her at Princeton, and then just started kind of subbing regularly in her band. And, you know, I only had 2 years left of school, and I really liked being in New York and coming up and playing here. And, my wife now went to Columbia. So she was already here. So it was just kind of a natural progression. It wasn't like anything specific that brought me up here, but you know, a little bit of everything.
That's really interesting. You know, sometimes I talk to students about kind of following the path of least resistance, not in a way that says, you know, you're not working hard and trying to promote yourself, but sometimes the thing that's most natural and the thing that makes most sense is the thing you should be doing, you know, whether it's going to New York, you know, or staying wherever you're from, you know. And I know that's a big conversation for people in this area. Do I go to New York? Do I go to Chicago? Do I go study at this big university? Or do I, you know, try to make a living where I am and contribute in the way that I can? That's really interesting. And Maria Schneider, of course, is one of the all-time greats of contemporary music composition. Again, no genre label needed there, but some people would call her a jazz composer. But that's super heavy. I mean, playing your ensemble must just be very challenging and really kind of, I don't know, like a mind-bending experience. It really challenges you to be the best you can.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, obviously she's got the most premier musicians of New York who's played with her band forever, you know, like Tony Cadillac and, you know, Keith O'Quinn plays trombone, and, you know, a lot of younger people too. And Clarence Penn played drums, and, you know, George Flynn is like one of the most unbelievable bass trombone players you'll ever hear, you know, and and it's, you know, and everyone is like that. Steve Wilson, Donny McCaslin, you know, and it's just, you know, so you really want to, you don't want to show up unprepared, I guess is the best way to put that, you know.
it's yeah, that pressure, you know what I mean? That pressure of having your peers around you all playing their butts off. Those are the great things that we love as musicians to inspire us and be the best we can. So you have that side of your career where you're playing really serious music with Maria. And that, in fact, the last time I saw you was with Maria in Savannah. I think that was the last time we got a chance to actually see one another.
Oh, that's right. And we went in and grabbed some vegan food.
That's right. That was good. That place was good. Southern vegan food. Who would have thought?
Southern vegan food.
But
it's a and thing.
Of course, that's true. That was an amazing show. It was great to hear you in that context. But I also knew and had heard that you were playing with people like Harry Connick Jr. and, you know, all kinds of other, you know, pop stars, and you're playing Aladdin on Broadway and that kind of thing. So how does that work? Like, how do you balance these two kinds of musical worlds, and how did those gigs come to be? How did you end up with Harry Connick's band, and how did you end up on Aladdin?
Sure. So in terms of Harry Connick's band, again, just kind of right place at right time. A good friend of mine, Joe Barotti, plays bass trombone with him, and either someone couldn't make it or something, you know, like the normal thing. And I got asked to sub, and then, you know, one gig turned into two, and then I ended up being with him for about 5 years. You know, and the great thing about Aladdin, you know, before I had Aladdin, I subbed on a lot of different Broadway shows, which is a lot of fun too. And then I was fortunate to get asked to do Aladdin. And the great thing about having a chair in a Broadway orchestra is that it allows you a little more flexibility and stability, you know? So if I need to go on the road for say 6 weeks with Harry or something like that, I could take a leave from Aladdin, and then my gig would be here when I got back as well, you know, as long as the show is still running, which luckily Aladdin's been a strong running show. Yeah. So, you know, it's just, you try and balance everything you can and do as much as you can whilst, you know, not driving yourself insane or running ragged or anything like that. So, sure. You know, a lot of it has, I have to say, is, you know, when preparation meets opportunity, that's a real thing, you know?
I was going to say it seems to be a theme that I'm hearing, that it's kind of right place, right time, and you're prepared for that opportunity when the door opens. You know, it's kind of like those quintessential stories of all the jazz greats, you know, Miles showing up to the bandstand and, you know, Dizzy Gillespie asking him to sit in, or you know, whatever, watching Charlie Parker. I mean, these stories are real, right? These are the experiences that we have. You're in the right place with your instrument ready to go. And so let's take a listen to you playing with Harry Connick. This is a clip from a performance on American Idol. Do you want to say anything about this, or should we just roll it?
I mean, it was when Harry was a judge in American Idol, and we flew out to LA and did a performance for all the contestants.
Great.
Look out now. Not come by me. Come talk to me, baby. Tell me how. We can't come by. Try me out. If you get excited, take me home. I'd love to be invited. Once we're there, she'd be delighted. We could rock all night. Wait and see. You know that we just might fit together, little baby. That would be my lucky day. Thank you.
Okay.
Sorry about this.
Oh, you're good.
There we go. Again, just killing. Of course, he had big lead trumpet feature on that at the shout section at the end. Man, unbelievable. What a great band as well. What was that like?
Yeah. You know, it was a little nerve-wracking because, you know, he had his core people that he brought out, like Lucian and the drummer and basically the whole rhythm section, and then just a few select horns. So obviously LA has unbelievable musicians. So it was nerve-wracking to be just, you know, you get put in that spot, very little rehearsal. And, you know, when the red light's on, the red light's on. So, hope for the best.
So it seems like sight reading has been a really important part of your career as a performer, you know, as a trumpet player, whether it's sitting down in a Broadway show or sitting in with Maria or Harry Connick or something, you're always kind of reading something and having to make music of it right then, you know?
Yeah, I think that's accurate. I don't know if it's as much sight reading as, you know, being able to assimilate things really, really quickly. You know, I think you can get like one or two chances, or like with Maria's band, like her music is so hard, like she'll send a lot of that out, but it's, you know, it's when you get with in a room or in a rehearsal with other people, how quickly can you assimilate all that information to make it sound like music, right? I think that's really what it comes down to.
That's great. So we're also looking for some insights from our artists about what it's, you know, what it takes to become successful, you know, in this field. And you know, some things we do as music students when we're going through undergrad or grad school seem a little futile at some points. It's like, man, do I really need to use this on the gig? Am I really going to have to be sight reading that much? Or am I really going to have to transpose? Or am I really going to have to, you know, do X, Y, and Z? Was there anything that you kind of point to in your development or through your schooling? Because it seems like you went straight through, right?
Undergrad, yeah, I did go straight through. Yes. I mean, I was lucky, you know, when I was at Miami, especially, you know, doing all those rehearsals and, you know, we had so many guest artists and so many things that you're just constantly reading new music, you know, and you're just given the opportunity to practice those skills, you know, assimilating quickly. And then you go do gigs and you work on that, you know, it's just, you're playing so much that, you know, I think it's like, do as much as you can handle, you know, but don't do any more, because then there is an actual drawback, right? I think a couple times, you know, I would find myself stretched too thin, you know, and there's downsides to that too. Like, you want to be as busy as you possibly can, right? But you also want to sound as best as you possibly can. So if you're too busy to sound, you know, at the best for everything, you know, there's a downside to that too.
Yeah, that's a big concern for some musicians. And you know, there's a lot of that conversation happening, you know, in the world of culinary arts and so on and so forth, many of the gig careers where it's like, how much do you sacrifice your own health, happiness, the balance that you expect from a healthy, happy lifestyle, you know? Because like you're saying, if you stretch yourself too thin, then sometimes your performance can be sacrificed in some ways. And sometimes the amount isn't as good as having the quality.
Need. Yeah, I mean, I definitely think it just basically comes down to perfecting your craft. So you feel comfortable in any situation. You know, there's no drawback to sight reading. There's no drawback to learning transpose. There's no, like, all of those things that, you know, we say we hated doing in school. Like, there's really no drawback to any of those. Like, do I really need this? Yeah. Well, no, but it's not going to hurt you either, you know? Right. And as long as you feel like you're maintaining a high level of your craft, you know, anything you practice will only help that.
Sure.
You know,
theory, ear training, history classes, you know, things like that.
Yeah. I don't know about the history classes, but I'm talking strictly performing, you know.
Yeah.
I could have dealt without some of those 8 a.m. history classes, to be perfectly honest.
That's so funny. So we're talking about your career as a performer thus far, but you do so much more than perform. I mean, you have a great sense of humor, right? I've known you to have a great sense of humor since I met you. And it kind of seems like what I'm also hearing is that the relationships that you build, right, the connections, or the way that you assimilate not only musically but in from a personality standpoint with other people on the bandstand or in a working environment is really important. Is that an experience that you found to be true as well, where it's like,
yeah,
I know I got that gig just because I was kind of a nice person and easy to work with or whatever?
Yeah, I mean, that's a huge part of it. I mean, especially like when you take a Broadway pit or something like that, you know, you're in very close quarters with these people night after night after night. And, you know, you want to be surrounded by people who are cool and, you know, don't make you feel uncomfortable or are easy to get along with, you know, things like that. I mean, you do hear the horror stories about that in the pits and things like that. And, you know, I always say, you know, show up, be quiet, be nice. And that goes a long way.
It really does. It really does. Let's share something that shows a little bit of your sense of humor, I suppose.
All right.
And of course, you always have to pair, you know, a sense of humor with a serious musical sense. So this is a recording that you made of Let It Go.
Let It Go.
But you called this Let It Augie. And this is an arrangement you did for four trumpets. And you call this a bit of a quarantine project because we're all going a little crazy in quarantine. So this was your way of
yeah. it was either I'm losing it or, you know, or I'm okay. A little bit of both.
I love it. I love it. I just got to say, my daughter's really into Frozen right now. We've been watching a lot of that. So I'm going to show her this when we're done with the session and I'll see what she thinks.
All right. All right.
Here we go. So you did that arrangement for four trumpets.
I did. Yeah.
It's great. It sounds great, man. That's amazing. So do you do a bit of arranging as well?
Yeah. Yeah. I love to arrange. I would love to do more videos like that. I was thinking about trying to, you know, like take either Disney songs or maybe pop songs or, you know, yeah, just fun things like that.
Yeah, I really like that approach. And that's something that seems to be another through line in your career is that there tends to be this sense of like having fun and being approachable and that kind of thing. That's always part of what you do, you know. And you even have a record label, right? The Playtime.
I do. Yeah, yeah. So, long time ago. Yeah. I always forget how old I am now, because I feel young. Yeah, I did a kids record because I had all these nephews running around. I have five siblings, so I'm the youngest of five. My parents kept trying until they got it right. And then, so, you know, I was like, oh man, they love it when I play trumpet for them. So I just did this like really easy duo record. My buddy Gabe Evans and I did all these like well-known kids tunes that are in the public domain, and people seemed to really like it. So we started this label called Playtime Music, you know, just to give it a little more control. Like, I don't know, just something like you want your own, because at the end of the day, you know, there are all these gigs, and I think now more than ever, people are realizing this during everything that's going on, like, you know, the person who can really do what you need is you. You know what I mean? And that's kind of sparked some other projects. And, you know, I was talking to a buddy of mine once. He goes, you know, you don't want to be always just sitting by the phone, you know, waiting for that call. Like make, you know, we always hear make the phone ring, but also like just start making the calls, like saying, I have this project. You know what I mean? And really, really give the control to yourself and put it in your own hands. And I wish I would have realized that earlier in my career, because at first I'm thinking I need to play with all these people. I need to do all these things, which is super important. And I would not be anywhere where I am today without all those experiences, obviously. But I wish I would have started on the side more of my own growing myself more. You know what I mean? So it's Augie Haas that is getting booked as opposed to so-and-so of, you know what I mean? Maria Schneider, and I play with Maria Schneider, or, you know, you want to be that headline and that kind of thing, if that makes sense.
Yes. Yeah. That's really smart. That's really smart. And it shows kind of like an entrepreneurial intelligence that, some people don't really think about. You know, one of the questions we're asking our students is how do we prepare for life after school? Because often the picture isn't clear when you've graduated with a degree in music performance or education, what you're actually going to do, you know?
Sure.
People don't really have a sense of like how to actually make a living then, now that you have this degree that says you can do X, Y, and Z. They haven't really maybe taken a step back and thought, what is it that I really want to do? Is there something that I want to make, or is there something that I need to do in order to be successful? And you've done so many things. Like you said, you started this label, Playtime. And I was wondering if that was the case where you were just surrounded by a lot of nieces and nephews, and it was like a necessity situation where it's like, hey, it'd be kind of fun to play trumpet to entertain the kids. And then,
yeah, you know, and that's grown into like 7 albums now and a couple of books that I release, everything, you know. And it's just a kind of, you know, I can umbrella everything I do under that. And, you know, doing all these projects, you know, I just take whatever money comes from that and try and pay for the next project, which has been interesting too, you know?
Yeah. Let's talk about that. Cause you did release a children's book most recently, and that was kind of the segue I wanted to make. So you're a performer, right? But you released a children's book. I love it.
Yeah.
Little Augie and his trumpet, Augie first and his pressing. Trumpet.
Yeah.
Awesome. Are you going to read us a few pages? Are you going
to? Only if you want me to, but I don't think anybody wants that.
So what was this inspired by? Again, it's kind of this, you know, a continuation of what you were doing before, but you were sitting at home. Now it's COVID. I don't have any gigs. Why not write a children's book?
Yeah. So I'd actually written the story, you know, one day, you know, you just, you know, sometimes you hear a tune and you want to write it down right away. Or sometimes you get, you know, I think as musicians, we're creative in a lot of ways. You don't need to limit yourself to music. And so I wrote down this story and I was always like, yeah, I'll illustrate it someday, or maybe I won't, or I'll get someone to illustrate it, or, you know. And then COVID hit and it looked like we weren't going to be doing anything for a while. So it, you know, I got Adobe and kept bugging some of my friends who really know those programs. And, you know, I drew everything by hand and then I traced it and, you know, it came out to this book and I'm really proud of it. And, you know, people seem to like it and it, you know, it could be a whole new other section of what you do. And the best part about it is it's still a creative outlet. You know,
yeah.
One thing I'll test is like when you go to school for music and you're like, you know, I play trumpet, you play trumpet or whatever, you're like trumpet, 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 trumpet. And you kind of have this tunnel vision of like, that's the only thing you can do, which is like so far from the truth, you know? And I wish I would have realized that a little earlier too. I mean, all of these things that we learn in school can be applied to so many different things we do. Like I could illustrate a kid's book because I know what it takes to like learn a new craft or learn a craft, right? And I applied all of that knowledge and discipline of learning the trumpet all these years, kind of the same way of like, well, how am I going to draw this book or illustrate this book? Right. And now I've just illustrated a book for a buddy of mine, for his children's book. Right. And like, you never know what opportunity is going to happen from something new too, you know, the cause and effect or chain reaction. Now we're talking about doing this whole series and we have, you know, a publisher is interested in, it's like, wow, you know, where was this like 14 years ago or whatever, you know, if I would have like maybe applied myself and not been so tunnel vision of like trumpet is the answer, you know, to everything. So always keep your, you know, peripherals on and know what's going on around you. Cause I think that was a kind of a weakness of mine.
That is really interesting. That's a great perspective to bring to people. And exactly one of the reasons why I wanted to have you share your experiences, because you have so many offerings. You know, not just musically, but actual offerings. Like you have a web store with some merchandise and everything like that. Like if you go to Augie Haas,
kind of dig into that more, and you know, it's all a big learning curve. And you know, just I always say, surround yourself with good people, and you know, and maybe someone who knows a little bit more than you. Sure. You know, because I certainly have not gotten here by myself, or you know, I would never have been able to do this book by myself. You know, I've tried to make a point to surround myself with good people who I trust, and you know, who don't mind me bugging them about all the questions I have, and all those things too.
That's great. Well, you have another book too. You have it was earlier on in your career, coming out of doctoral school. You have Build Your Range.
Yeah,
tell us about that.
Build Your Range. I mean, I wrote my dissertation. It was called The Art of Playing Trumpet in the Upper Register. And it got like a crazy amount of downloads for a dissertation. I'm actually like the number one downloaded dissertation at the University of Miami, which I like out of all fields, you know, which I find crazy. So that book was such a wide scope of trumpet. You know, it talked about diet, talked about teeth, it talked about, you know, different methods of playing. And you know, one thing it didn't do as much was just like have a practical, like these are some exercises to play to work on building your range. So I just wrote down, you know things I did, and then made a play along with it. And it's been pretty successful.
That's great. So all these things are available, of course, on your website. Is that correct?
I think you're frozen. You're back.
I'm back. Can you see this? We can see your screen.
I can see that.
Great. So I was just going to show everybody your website.
It's your screen.
Yeah. And all this stuff is available on your website if they'd like to download it or purchase it from your web store.
Yeah.
Yeah, cool.
I'm pretty active on Instagram stuff too. So if you ever... I always post about all that stuff too, so...
All of your records, and your latest record features you singing, in fact. That's something I want to show as well. And just ask you briefly before we go into this. This is a little snippet of Dream a Little Dream, but have you always sung, or is this something that was kind of new to your career?
It's new. I've always sung and enjoyed singing. Generally I didn't do it in public, but I started, you know, working with my own band a little more, in a trio setting, mostly just piano, bass, and trumpet. And I was just noticing, like, it was nice for audiences to have a break from trumpet. You know, it's even if you stick in a mute or whatever, like, you know, it's just still instrumental music. And I ended up just singing one tune one night because I think I was feeling tired or something. And like all of a sudden people started listening a little more. I was like, oh, wow. Like, maybe I should start singing more. And a couple of people came up to me after the gig, was like, why don't you sing more? So the album before this album, I debuted as a singer. And then we did this, my buddy Andrew Neasley, who produced it and did all the arrangements. We did this album last year, and it's just been a fun thing. It's nice to get the trumpet off the face too.
Yeah. Great. Let's take a listen. This is a little album teaser.
Stars shining bright above you. Night breezes seem to whisper, I love you. Birds singing in a sycamore tree. Dream a little dream of me. Say nighty night and kiss me. Just hold me tight and tell me you'll miss me. While I'm alone as blue as can be. Dream a little dream of me. Stars fading but I linger on there. Still craving your care. I'm longing to linger till dawn there. Just say this. Sweet dreams till sunbeams find you. Sweet dreams that leave all worries.
Man, sounds awesome. It sounds so good.
Thanks, man, appreciate it.
You know, I remember you singing songs in the dressing rooms and before shows, you know, on the tour bus and that kind of thing. You know, and it's so funny how sometimes just this thing that we do, maybe subconsciously or just as a way to, I don't know, pass the time or whatever, can end up becoming something that you do as part of your living. So you kind of fell into this as kind of a way to kind of take a break from the trumpet and diversify your musical offerings.
Yeah.
Do you have any like vocal training as well? Did you seek out some lessons and that kind of
thing? I did seek out some lessons. I took like some like straight up traditional like voice technique lessons. And then I got together with a couple of like jazz singers and, you know, tried to apply those things to, you know, stylistically and, you know, really trying to find your voice because, you know, goofing around in the dressing room or on the bus or, you know, everyone says they sing in the shower, you know, is a lot different than like, oh, I actually have to do this. Yes. You know, so I did want to take some lessons and be prepared, but same time, I didn't want to take too many lessons because I think at a certain point you get inside your head then, you know, and it's something that you do naturally. You know, I do think that, you know, there is such thing as over rehearsing and things like that. So it was hard to find the balance. You know, you just got to stay musically and surround yourself with a couple of people you trust too. You know, my wife will tell me if it's bad for sure. So
yeah, you need that person in your life, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Don't just surround yourself with what I like to call yes people. Yeah. You know, you gotta surround yourself with people who aren't afraid to tell you if something's not good. You know, it's just as important.
Have you found that that helps you with your musicianship on your instrument? Or have you found that But this is opening up other opportunities for you as well. It's like, now I know that Augie sings too, so I'm going to hire him because.
Yeah, I mean, I started getting calls to do gigs as just a singer, and I was like, whoa. I actually turned a couple of them down because I didn't feel like I would be either the right fit or had enough time to prepare. I did one because it was only like 3 or 4 tunes, you know? But yeah, I thought that was kind of crazy. It's like, you know, here's a whole nother thing. Like, why wasn't I working on this, you know? Yeah. But I guess it all happens for a reason when it happens and everything like that. But yeah, it definitely has opened up a lot of doors and got me into some gigs I probably wouldn't have been able to do as a standalone, just trumpet player, you know?
Yeah, you know, I like that that story that you're telling and the idea of having these moments, you know, within your career. And in fact, we're gonna have Danny Young on the series in a month. And
he's nice.
Yeah, so Danny's a drummer, but he's also a singer. He's a fabulous singer. And he was talking to me the other day over break. We were just catching up, saying something very similar to what you're saying. As soon as he started to get known for his quality of his vocals, the way he could sing harmonies, he started to get called for gigs as a singer primarily. He's like, now I need to shed that, you know, that's part of my practice now as a musician.
Yeah.
So I just want to mention to everyone who's out there watching us and kind of engaging with us that you can ask questions. You can always type a question to us and we can have Dr. Augie Haas speak directly with you, answer your questions. If you have something specific, if you're a trumpet player, if you're a musician or a singer, anything, if you're an entrepreneur out there, if you're just curious, you can always engage us with a question.
I will add to the singing thing is that, you know, I didn't realize it, but I always make my students sing, you know, because especially for trumpet, I mean, you know, that at a certain point, the valves don't really make a difference, especially regards to upper register playing. So you really have to hone in on your ears and be able to hear it. And I always say, if you cannot sing it, like, you can't play it, you know? So whatever it is, it could be a etude, it could be a transcription, you know, a lot of the transcribing I do, I just try and memorize it singing and then try and teach myself the transcription from the singing. Right. I think that's like a highly effective way. It helps with a lot of different things all at once as well. You know, it checks a lot of things off the list of, you know, ear training, vocabulary, time, pitch, you know, all those things. You know, singing is just, it's never going to hurt you.
Yeah. I think that's something as instrumentalists, we tend to, avoid doing because we hide behind our instruments. You know, we've always the choice was choir or band, you know, in middle school or elementary school or something. It's choir or band. Which one are you going to choose? And those that were more courageous chose choir, and the rest of us chose, you know, to play instruments, and we hide behind our instruments sometimes. But it seems like what you're saying and what many of our students know is that the instrument is just an extension of your voice, so we do have to work on that. So there was, you already answered the question. I was just going to ask where your music is available.
I got the question.
Great.
Spotify, Apple Music. It's no longer iTunes. Amazon Music, YouTube, all, like, every platform, you know.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I want to show maybe just one last thing. Again, it's a bit of a follow-up to this idea of using your sense of humor and your personality in order to be creative, and creative in the very real sense of the word, where you're actually making something. Because I get the sense that when you get an idea, you have this capacity to actually follow up on it, where some people might think, oh, it's just a silly idea, or it's just, you know, it's just a fleeting thought or something. It seems to be that when you get a thought, you're like,
for better or worse, I generally follow up.
Okay, you follow up.
For better or worse, I generally will come through with the idea, you know. I could probably have solved world peace if I put, you know, my efforts towards something good, but as this video you'll see. But
but instead it's beer bottle openers. This is called the H-bomb.
Just bottle openers, you know. Soda comes in bottles too.
True.
Comes, you know.
mineral water, whatever.
Exactly.
You're drinking all that fancy,
fancy water that Max drinks.
Okay. This is called the H bomb, and this is your advertisement for it. I love this. Here we go.
Welcome. What can I get you? We have a special on bottles tonight if you're interested.
Surprise me.
Oh my God. Every time I watch that. So good. It's so well produced as well. Your video editing skills are on point.
I will say that those are not my video editing skills. That's my buddy. So I pulled in a lot of favors, or not favors, but you know, we're all cool, you know, friends. So the guy who was the bartender was the genie in Aladdin, but we went to Roosevelt together. You know, another guy at Aladdin is like an amazing videographer. We've done a couple of these Christmas videos for the past year for Broadway Cares, Equity Fights AIDS. They do a big Christmas album every year, and the past 2 years we've written the song, and then he's, you know, we've made these big videos. So he's an amazing editor, Angelo Soriano. We're actually getting ready to do a really fun video, so keep your eyes out. We're collabing on some more stuff, so he's amazing.
It looks so good. It's so funny, and the idea of just, you know, it's every trumpet player's dream to have a bottle opener on their own mouthpiece. And so you actually have these manufactured by Warburton. Is that correct?
Yeah,
you've got a
bunch. I was I don't know what. I was down there visiting Terry one day, and I was like, I had actually made one myself. I had went to Jay Landers Brass in New York, and I used his files, and he helped me just kind of make the thing, and I showed it to Terry. I said, how could we mass produce these? So we did.
How do you manage all of this? I mean, you've got children's book, you've got the record label, you've got the mouthpiece, you've got your music on Spotify and Apple Music. Like, how do you manage all these different not only careers or whatever you want to call them, but revenue streams? Like, how does that all, you know, most of us are just used to getting one paycheck from one employer. How does that work for you? Not to get too far in the weeds, but.
No. I mean, all of those things go through my label, Playtime Music. So anything that goes through there. And, you know, obviously I would recommend this to any musician, because our income can be so, you can come from a lot of different places, but that all goes through Playtime Music. And then on my personal taxes, you get a thing called a K-1 from your LLC. And, you know, I have a great accountant who's also a musician, and, you know, I let the professionals handle that, so I don't get any call to the IRS or anything like that.
Oh, that's good. That's good. Yeah. We want you out of that mess.
Yeah. Yeah. So like the book and everything, that's all, that just all goes to an account with my company. Okay. So
that's so interesting, man. I'm so glad we got a chance to talk today. And I want to encourage any last minute questions.
Yeah, likewise.
Here. We addressed the aspect of where we can find music.
There is one in the Q&A.
What are some of your future goals or plans you would like to accomplish?
I mean, that's a great question. And it's a great question during these times. I definitely have plans to do more children's books. I have some other projects that I'm not at liberty to talk about that have nothing to do with music. I will say that I wish I had it with me right here, but I just developed a mute with a buddy that is a fully functional cup mute, and it will also be a fully functional flask. So, you know, just I'm all about having fun and and doing creative things. Working on a new trumpet book and some more merch line, and you know, I'm just trying to build the brand and have fun while doing it. I think a lot of people get bogged down and just say, ah, that's too much. But, you know, just slowly check things off the list and, you know, bite-sized pieces. I'm like, I don't have any with me right here, but like I have crazy lists that go every, you know, and you reassess and you try and find the balance. And, you know, I will say that one thing that helps me dramatically with the balance and, you know, managing everything is find something you love to do that isn't music, if that's what you do for a living. You know what I mean? Like you, Max had mentioned earlier about cooking, like nothing can go wrong while I'm in the kitchen. Even if I burn the food, like it is something creative that stimulates me. And it's also something that brings me extreme joy. So it's great for mental health. You know, I like to eat, all those things. So it's, I would recommend finding something that you love to do that isn't what you do to support yourself necessarily, you know, a creative outlet and a little escape, I like to call it. I think that's really, really important.
Yeah, that's great advice. That's great advice. So often we're kind of isolated as musicians, you know, locked in a practice room or, you know, just doing the thing that we do. And some of us have these crisis moments, you know, in when you're in undergrad or graduate school and you just realize, man, what am I doing this for? I'm torturing myself, you know, just to go out and play a gig. And now that there aren't any gigs, we really have to reassess why we're playing. Is it something that's self-fulfilling that we really enjoy doing it? Is it cathartic? Or is it because we want to bring joy to other people? And now we have to figure out different ways to do it. Okay.
Yeah, for sure.
One more question.
Outside of COVID,
how often would you perform in California?
I guess it just depends on the year and what people are doing. I would say I was always out there like at least 3-4 times a year, doing something. I was supposed to be out there in the fall, this past fall. You know, I had lined up a tour with my band to like kind of go from Seattle all the way down to San Diego, and stopping along the way at different places. But obviously COVID happened, but I hope to like put all that back in motion when, you know, the world reopens. And, you know, I'm excited for the world to reopen. And I think it's going to be really great for music. I think that people are really thirsting for art and entertainment, and you know, it wasn't by accident the Roaring Twenties came after the Spanish flu. So I'm hoping that we can do our own version of the Roaring Twenties.
Yeah, people are gonna have a lot to offer, I think. And it's been said that, you know, there are obviously frontline workers that that we, you know, think of as our heroes now.
Yeah.
But in that conversation have been entertainers, musicians, and people who are in the creative arts. And you are so important to us because you're the people that make life worth living sometimes, you know?
Yeah.
So we thank you. And that's the reason we have this series, so that we can be some kind of support and outlet for, again, not only our students, but for the musicians who are out there just trying to figure this all out and bring some joy and light back into the world in 2021 now. So it looks like there's one final question. How did you discover your passion for trumpet, and do you play any other instruments? And I guess that we'll leave that at as the last word.
Yeah. When I first started playing, I just begged my parents to let me play an instrument, and I originally wanted to play the French horn. I don't know why.
I thought it looked cool or whatever. I was 10. And they're like, oh, you know, you should really play trumpet. So, you know, I think I was more excited to play an instrument. And once I got it in my hand, like that was the first one, I was like off to the races. I was listening to Louis Armstrong growing up. So maybe that had something to do with it too. And then Max and I were in this group together called Kids from Wisconsin, which is a group that tours the state of Wisconsin in the summers. And I did it when I was really young. I was like 15 years old. And, you know, I was like, wait. And I, you know, we made a per diem every week. And when you're 15, I think it was like $150 a week or something like that. And I was like, this is amazing. Like as a 15-year-old to be making money playing the trumpet, like, and I didn't have to be around my parents and everything. So, you know, and then I, you know, what, and like anything else, one thing led to another, and like, you just get more passionate about it. And the more I did it, the more I loved it. And the more I performed, like the happier I was. And I think that, you know, it really, you know, it really helped me rather than me, you know, opposite. There's like this great documentary on Netflix right now called My Teacher, the Octopus, or the Octopus, My Teacher, or something like about this guy who like rediscovered, you know, his love for the water because of an octopus, you know. And, you know, I feel like trumpet did that for me in performing. Like every time I was had a trumpet in my hand, I was performing, I was happy. And like, that's what, you know, really fueled my passion.
Man, it's been so good to catch up with you. And, you know, once, you too. Once this all blows over, you know, you have a place to stay and to play. We'll open up the concert hall to you. And
I would love it.
Yeah, we'll have you out as a guest artist. And we wish you the best of luck, and we look forward to your next releases, whether they be children's books or CDs, recordings. We'll see you on the road. For those of you
who are joining us,
they are, we'll look for them. So everybody out there, make sure to go to augiehaas.com and check out what he's doing. Next week, we have our president, the college president, Cosumnes River College president, Edward Bush, is going to talk to us about his presidential playlist. He's created a special playlist, the music he really loves and enjoys. So we're going to talk with him about his love and interest in music. And we hope to see you all then, same time, same place. And from all of us here at CRC Music, thank you. Thank you, Augie, and everybody. Have a great weekend. Enjoy. Bye.